Hey, how's it going, guys? It's Nate here. And Skyrim, as well as the entire universe of the Elder Scrolls in which the game and province exist, is a mysterious place. One laden with magic, ghosts, strange creatures, and supernatural occurrences. Clearly, in a place like this, there are going to be quite a few things we players don't totally understand, or have the firmest grasp on. But many of the questions Skyrim and the Elder Scrolls V leave us asking are rather fun to ponder. So, we'll be spending the next 12 to 15 minutes doing just that, as we take a look at 5 more of the most enthralling mysteries in or about the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Part 16, I think. Starting off, Delvin Mallory is a Breton sneak trainer and highly respected member of Riften's Thieves Guild. Throughout the guild's questline, he remains a strong ally of the players, and we're constantly sent to him for both advice and new contracts. Well, as it turns out, the Thieves Guild isn't the only criminal faction Delvin has a relationship with, as he also has strong ties to the Dark Brotherhood, and its leader, Astrid, as well. You see, as any assassin who's worked their way up to a listener will tell you, shortly into the Dark Brotherhood storyline, we're sent to meet with Delvin at Riften's Thieves Guild's headquarters. As Astrid claims he's an old friend with an extensive knowledge of jewels and trinkets, we need to visit him to ask him about some jewels someone's trying to pay the Brotherhood with. And that's pretty much that. He also operates as a sort of merchant towards the player, and after the Brotherhood storyline has been concluded, by the way, spoiler alert, most of the guild dies and your old sanctuary burns down, when you move into your new sanctuary in Dawnstar, it's Delvin who sells you furniture for the place. Pretty neat. But how exactly did Astrid know Delvin? How is this high-ranking thief so close with the leader of the Dark Brotherhood? Well, the answer's actually quite simple, but it opens up a whole nother basket of questions. You see, Delvin used to be a Dark Brotherhood assassin himself. At least, that's what Skyrim's official game guide tells us, which states in a small subparagraph describing Delvin Mallory that when he first joined the Thieves Guild many decades ago, he accidentally killed someone during his first job. As a sort of punishment slash rehabilitation tactic, the guild's leader, at the time a man named Gallus, sent Delvin to join the Dark Brotherhood for a while. Now, that's all the manual tells us, but that must explain the depths of Delvin's relationship with Astrid, right? He was sent to join the Dark Brotherhood for a while, and she was his boss. That's it, right? Well, not exactly. Let's talk about the Thieves Guild for a bit. When we join it, it's being led by a man named Mercer Frey. At the climax of the guild's questline, it's revealed that Mercer is in fact a traitor. Not only did he secretly kill the guild's last leader and frame it on somebody else so he could get the job, he's also been stealing from the faction's coffers, and has even taken some extremely valuable artifacts for himself. Eventually, we the player reveal this treachery to the rest of the faction, and everyone is very angry to find out that their old boss was really an evil person all this time, including Delvin Mallory. But Delvin may say something very telling when he discovers that Mercer's a traitor. Take a listen.
Stabbed in the back. It's like the Dark Brotherhood all over again.
This appears to suggest Delvin's been through this kind of backstabbing before, at the hands of the Brotherhood. Perhaps that's part of the reason why he left. Though, at the same time, the manual makes it seem like his tenure with the Brotherhood was supposed to be temporary anyway. So, what happened? Did Astrid betray Delvin like she later does us? She and him seem to be on pretty good terms now, and he even refers to her in a friendly tone when we visit him on Astrid's orders. So, what gives? Did someone else within the guild betray Delvin? I suppose only he knows, and Delvin won't tell. Next on our list, while this one is certainly a mystery very relevant to Skyrim, it really concerns the entire Elder Scrolls universe as a whole. Who killed King Coolacane? So, that name, Coolacane, may not sound very familiar to you, but rest assured, it occupies a very important spot in the Elder Scrolls and Skyrim's own history. In the late Second Era, King Coolacane was a petty king occupying some land in Northern Cyrodiil. While you may not know his name, you certainly can recall his favorite general, Tiber Septim, or Hjalti Earlybeard, as he was called when he was still a general. In case you don't already know the tale, back at the turn of the Second Era, Tiber Septim, again then known as Hjalti Earlybeard, a relative nobody enlisted in King Colocaine's army, somehow became a general, and conquered pretty much the majority of Cyrodiil and Skyrim for him. In the name of his king, with the power of his Thum, Hjalti Earlybeard was able to decimate any forces who opposed him, and quickly built a massive army of followers, which he used to capture the Imperial City and much more, all for his king. However, shortly after the Imperial City was captured by Hjalti, something very convenient happened. Colocaine was mysteriously assassinated and left without an heir. With no candidate left for the throne, and Hjalti already being extremely popular with the army, he decided to take the crown for himself, and took on the name Tiber Septim. This is how he came to power. He was a general for a king, conquered quite a bit for him, then oopsie, king died, oh no, and he stepped up to take the throne. This, of course, was only just the beginning for Tiber Septim and his new dynasty. He would go on to conquer the rest of Tamriel too, and so much more, but that's beside the point. The obvious question to ask is, who killed the old king and why? Well, despite my tone clearly suggesting Tiber had something to do with it to further his own ambitions, there's a bit more to the story. Most of what we know about Colocaine's assassination stems from the Pocket Guide to the Empire's first edition, which claims Colocaine was killed by a Nightblade, hired by some rival Breton nobles. Apparently, while the assassin did successfully kill the old king, he also set the Imperial Palace on fire, and Tiber Septim was evidently there at the time, and the assassin tried to kill him too, but this time only succeeded in slitting the man's throat. Tiber, of course, didn't die. The story goes that Tiber emerged from the burning Imperial Palace with one hand on his bleeding neck and the other on the old king's crown. Due to this major injury, he would actually never be able to use his Thum again, and would always have to speak with a whisper. So the story goes. This is essentially everything we know. The old king's death is certainly very lucky timing for the man who would go on to take his place. But considering Tiber himself was also gravely wounded, maybe it really was just some angry Breton noblemen. Additionally, I have to point out that we still have no idea whatever happened to this assassin. His fate is left unaddressed. Did he escape the commotion scot-free? Was he captured by Imperial forces and later put on trial? Was he killed during the scuffle? We have no idea. You would think the man who assassinated such a notable king would at least have his name well recorded in history. Yet, it's not. Some suspect there was never any assassin at all. That Tiber himself killed the emperor and in the scuffle had his throat slit and accidentally set the palace on fire. Or maybe he purposely hurt himself so bad to avoid suspicion. We may never know the absolute reality behind the death of King Colocaine. But maybe Tiber Septim wasn't quite as honorable of a man as we all previously thought. Coming in at number 3, why does the Eye of Magnus look so much like the object at the center of the Orrery of Elden Root? Okay, so this one will definitely require quite a lot of context. So, the Eye of Magnus is a very mysterious thing in its own right. We discover it during the College of Winterhold questline, as we and a class of students are on a sort of field trip to the old Nord ruins of Sarthal. Sarthal was once the first Nord settlement in all of Skyrim thousands of years ago during the Morethic era. Legend has it that shortly after being founded, the city was the victim of a strange surprise attack by the region's native population of Snow Elves. Nearly the entire population was killed and the settlement was abandoned. However, one surviving Nord, a man named, you may have heard of him, Yskrimor, sailed back home to Atmora, the original Nordic homeland that is now lost, and came back with an army of 500 Nords that would go on to drive the Snow Elves to extinction in a bloody campaign of revenge. This is also the origins of the Companions Guild, by the way. Anyhow, as we prance about the ruins of this once mighty Nord settlement, towards the bottom of the dungeon, we happen upon the Eye of Magnus, a giant sphere evidently loaded with odd, unnatural energies. It's really unexplained what this thing is, however, it's clearly very, very powerful. The college somehow moves the Eye into their university building, and the remainder of the college's questline centers around our efforts to better understand the Eye of Magnus and stop a certain annoying Thalmor from using it for his own nefarious purposes. That said, it's never really established what the Eye of Magnus is supposed to be. Who made it? What is it capable of? Why was it in Sarthal? These questions are all left totally unanswered. Honestly, I always thought the college's storyline was kind of poorly written due to its failure to address these issues. Well, in the Elder Scrolls Online, we can stumble across an extremely similar object, at least in appearance. Beneath the city of Eldenroot, in the Bosmer province of Valenwood, we can discover an old alien ruin from thousands of years ago, called the Orrery. And at the center of the orrery is a very familiar-looking sphere. The object looks nay identical to the Eye of Magnus in everything but its color. Same shape, same size, same texture, you could easily mistake the two. Now, thankfully, we know a bit more about this orrery of Eldenroot. It was built thousands of years ago by a somewhat evil alien elven king named Enumeril. He constructed the device in an effort to help him mine sap from a particularly important nearby tree. It's a very long story, but he failed. When we visit this place in ESO, many a centuries have passed, and all that are left are some pretty evil enemies. So, why do these spheres look so similar? The Eye of Magnus is almost a total mystery in its origins, however, the Orrery of Eldenroot, as we just discussed, we know was built by mortal elves many millenniums ago. Could it be that there's a reason these two objects look so similar? Maybe the Eye of Magnus in Sarthal was also constructed by mortals. Not gods or supernatural energies as many have previously assumed, but by people. Heck, maybe the Nords somehow built it, and that's why the elves surprise attacked the city. Maybe they were up to something. The true nature of why these spheres are so similar is anyone's guess. But perhaps they have more in common than just a shape. For a fourth spot, why are all Hagravens women? Okay, so this is admittedly a bit less of a game-changing mystery than whether or not Tiber Septim backstabbed his king or what the Eye of Magnus is supposed to be. But nonetheless, it's a fun question to ponder, and one that even the developers seem to be self-aware of. Hagravens are, of course, the ferocious, half-bird people that can commonly be encountered throughout many of Skyrim's caves and forests. It's suggested that they were once normal people who entered some odd pact with Hersine, Daedric God of the Hunt, to acquire their new abilities. They appear to sometimes entertain awkward alliances with the Forsworn of the Reach, and depend on magical attacks when in combat, though can also use their claws if push come to shove. And notably, not a single Hagraven we ever meet is a dude. Why? Well, the book Hags, Harpies, and Hagravens, written by a certain Azadia of Hammerfell, contains the following quote by a particular priest. It reads as follows, quote, "Consider hags, harpies, and hagravens," quoth he. "Are these monsters not all, each and every one, women, and therefore wicked?" End quote. Ignoring the context of this statement, it would seem as though other characters in the Elder Scrolls universe are at the very least aware of the fact that hagravens are exclusively female. So it's not like Bethesda was just too lazy to make a male model or something. According to the lore, hagravens are exclusively female. But is there a reason for it? Well, some have suggested the answer's simple. No, there isn't. Hagravens may just be modeled to sort of represent the witch trope we see featured in so many other films and media. Fantasy witches are just inherently feminine characters. So maybe that's the scope of it. Maybe that's the reason. It's simple. Others have pointed at Briarhearts, the exceptionally powerful, somewhat zombified Forsworn agents that have had their hearts replaced with Briarheart flowers. Maybe those are the male counterparts to Hagravens. Though, personally, I dispute this theory. Hagravens seem to be in some sort of pact with Hersine, Daedric God of the Hunt, as we mentioned, and Briarheart seem to get their power from a sort of necromantic ritual in which their heart is physically replaced. It seems like we're working with different energies here. Whatever the reason, it seems there are no male Hagravens in the world. Save for my father-in-law. And finally, last on our list, our final mystery is taking us to the tiny town of Rorikstead in Whiterun. Now, as we've discussed numerous times before on this channel, Rorikstead is already a very strange and mysterious place. A simple walk through the town won't reveal anything abnormal, but speak to some of the citizens, and you'll discover that Rorikstead is the recipient of what may be a strange magical gift. For whatever reason, Rorikstead boasts by far and away the most bountiful harvests of any set of farms in all of Skyrim. Like, by a long shot. And the settlement hasn't had a failed harvest since it was founded by Rorik decades ago. It seems like a pretty amazing blessing. Until you also realize that every single woman living in Rorikstead who's given birth has passed away during the process. So, there's certainly something weird going on here, but this is a topic we've explored before in previous videos. Instead, I want to direct our focus specifically on Jawan Manette and Sissel. So, Jawan Manette is a Breton mage who can best be described as Rorikstead's second-in-command. Way back during the Great War, he and Rorik, the settlement's founder, served together in the Imperial Legion, and Jawan even saved Rorik's life multiple times with healing spells. Now, he's a respected figure in Rorikstead, and even shares a house with Rorik. But he has an interesting relationship with a young girl living in the settlement named Sissel. Sissel lives with her sister Brit and her father Lemkil. Of course, her mother isn't in the picture due to the nature of the settlement. It seems Jawan is training Sissel in various magical elements. Take a listen to this potential conversation you may hear between the two characters.
Jawan?
Yes, child?
I was just wondering, the next time we meet, do you think maybe you could teach me some fire magic? Nothing dangerous, maybe a candle lighting spell?
By the eight, keep your voice down. Do you want the entire village to learn our secrets?
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to upset you.
Shh, it's fine, child, it's fine. But we must be cautious, What we do, the things I teach you, the others wouldn't understand.
I understand. I'm sorry. I just get so excited thinking about it. So, can we do some fire magic?
Most certainly not. But perhaps I can teach you how to put some candles out. We'll start there.
Oh, wonderful! I can't wait!
So, Jawan is clearly teaching this girl magic. But for whatever reason, he wants it to remain a secret. He doesn't want anyone to know that he's teaching her. Jawan desiring for their lessons to remain a secret isn't inherently abnormal for a place like Skyrim. Most Nords are quite superstitious about magic. But if you enter Jawan's home, well, Jawan and Rorik's home, that is, you can find a copy of the book Spirit of the Daedra hidden behind their bar. Spirit of the Daedra is, of course, a book commonly found in the possession of Daedra worshippers. It was written by Daedra themselves and contains all sorts of evil themes. Some have put two and two together and fear that Jawan is currently teaching, or may plan on teaching Sissel, some very dark arts. And that's why he wants their little lessons to remain, well, hidden from the rest of the town. There's, of course, also numerous theories that Daedra are behind Rorikstead's strange circumstances. It's thanks to Jawan and possibly Rorik's Daedra worship that the town is able to produce such successful harvests, and also the reason why women constantly pass away during birth. The great concern is that now, they may be looking for an apprentice. And with that, we are going to wrap up our 16th episode of 5 Spooky Mysteries in, or at the very least concerning, The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Thanks for stopping by, everybody. Which of these strange happenings or unexplained events did you find to be the most enthralling? And what unanswered questions do you have that you'd like to be tackled next? Leave a comment down below. Again, thanks so much for watching, and I hope to catch you all in my next video. Peace out, everyone.